Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Assalamu alaikum. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Today I will discuss, I hope it will be crucial or important subject actually. And actually in the meantime, it is a practical issue we should focus on. I can say it is a neglected and a forgotten issue. This is what's called post-hemodialysis recovery time as a new marker of adequacy. Our agenda today, we shall give an introduction, and then we shall move to why we measure the dialysis adequacy, what is called optimal dialysis should focus on also, hemodialysis patient symptomatic burden, post-dialysis fatigue, if we're getting major issue, and post-dialysis recovery time, why it does matter, and what did different studies tell us. And by the end, we shall go to this, what's called, can dialysis recovery time be improved? As all we know that over 2 million of people worldwide receive dialysis, this number is only a fraction of the people that theoretically would need it. All nephrologists are aware that patients receiving regular hemodialysis have extremely poor outcomes compared to the general population. Despite minor difference between countries, slight improvement over the last decade regarding the mortality and the morbidity for patients receiving hemodialysis. But still, the outcome unacceptably or remain unacceptably high mortality and morbidity. In the state, almost 1/4 of the patients beginning hemodialysis treatment or therapy die in the first year. And almost half of these patients, I mean 50%, die within 3 years. Plus, the overall quality of life is also poor, and the burden of the disease is very high. The term dialysis adequacy was coined 40 years back, or more than 40 years back in the last century, gained momentum with the advent of US National Cooperative Dialysis Study. And in this study, treatment failure was associated with fractional small solute clearance, expressed as urea, KT over V. And since that time, different methods to calculate KT over V has been introduced. But different authors argued that dialysis adequacy should also cover control of uremic symptoms, extracellular volume, blood pressure, improve survival, and the quality of life. And here we can focus on what's called the quality of life. One of the most important issues is to be a comfortable dialysis. We have long considered that quality of dialysis care revolve around achieving specific measurement, including lab results such as estimation of dry body weight, post-urea creatinine, pre-urea creatinine, and so. These measures, however, can limit the patient's ability to provide insights into what actually feels best to them individually. Post-hemodialysis fatigue is a common and complex phenomena that significantly reduce the health-related quality of life. Dialysis recovery time is a quantifiable, validated measure of post-dialysis fatigue. Ignoring this patient-reported feedback could lead to disconnection between the clinicians and the patient goals and potentially reduce the patient adherence. And unfortunately, that's what happened actually in the reality. So, the main target in dialysis is to improve the patient's quality of life. That means we should leave the patient or keep the patient feeling more healthy, less uremic complication like post-dialysis fatigue, headache, hypotension, less degree of anemia, better control of blood pressure. Target can be achieved by giving your patient an adequate dose of dialysis. And urea kinetic model, we cannot deny that it is a useful tool in calculating the dose of dialysis. So why should we measure the dialysis dose? There is a correlation for sure, literature-wise or evidence-based, that between the delivered dose of hemodialysis and the patient morbidity and mortality. But unfortunately, clinical symptoms and even the lab results alone are usually not a reliable measure. So what happens if smaller dose is given? That means we shall face a worse outcome in the form of death, falling the albumin level, hospitalization not related to access because The most common cause, as we know, that of the hospitalization of our patient is access-related problem, infection, and poor quality of life, like what's called post-dialysis fatigue. How to improve is very easy, as all we know, that we can manipulate in the blood flow, dialysate flow, dialyzer size, our surface area, and duration, and the frequency. So, KT over V should be a means, not a goal. Adequate is defined as barely satisfactory. So what we want to give our patients, in the state that with current adequate dialysis, or what we say adequate dialysis, target KT over V of 1.2, the dialysis patient death rate is 25%. The rehabilitation rate is less than 10%. And one among each five patients find life so miserable and he preferred to be dead. Sarcastically, KD guidelines as usual, and we consider these guidelines as a holy book, and they are not actually. KDUKI guidelines, 27 pages are devoted of KT over V. 4 pages to how to draw post dialysis sample, and only 2 pages to quality of life and satisfaction level. Patients on chronic dialysis deserve urgent and adequate answer to their need for better quality of life. So something is went wrong actually. And we should admit that one definition of lunacy or insanity is to do the same thing over and over and expect something different to happen. So a lot of criticism to KT over V, and I think my professor, Dr. Hisham Said, mentioned in most of his literature about this issue. But we cannot deny that still KT over V, and especially its modification, remains a rather useful measure of hemodialysis tools. What's optimal dialysis? Optimal dialysis, the reason that reaching adequate KT over V target does not confer optimal quality of life to dialysis patient. Actually, or really, we are tyrannized by the KT over V concept. What we call it adequate, when the mortality rate of the patient who adequately treated is 25%. It's more than cancer even. And also we have a lot of symptomatic burdens on the patient, like dizziness, fatigue, and hypotension, and the cramp, and vomiting. Actually, for our patient, this is not worth living. This is not a life worth living. As 20% of them ultimately prefer to die rather than to continue such a bad treatment, sorry to say. And stopping dialysis is now the second leading cause of death in dialysis patient in the state, following the cardiovascular disease. So optimal dialysis, as I said, it is a moving target. There is no one simple way to describe optimal dialysis. It will be a moving target, and description will change with the time. But how can we match this current dialysis methods with goals of dialysis? The available methods we have now, like hemodialysis, hemofiltration, hemodiafiltration, and all these types, are available to us, and nothing more we can offer the patient except transplantation. When analysis of the jobs to be done, the conclusion was that 3 times a week hemodialysis is by far the worst and should be replaced by daily hemodialysis. And the method that best solved all the jobs necessary was nightly long hemodiafiltration if applicable or if feasible. That is the only method that could remove beta-2 microglobulin, and we know what the drawbacks of this beta-2 microglobulin. So these are the outcome regarding optimal dialysis. We can dream as we want, but it is okay. We can attain better survival and the high health-related quality of life. Surprisingly, KT over V is only give one of the 16 targets of hemodialysis or optimal dialysis. And if we look at the item number 4, the absence of interdialytic symptom like fatigue, and the number 5 is no interference with ability to hold a job. So it is very crucial and very important to highlight these issues. So that's what's called multidimensional measure of dialysis. Actually, this is the only article I found regarding the link between the dialysis adequacy and the post-dialysis recovery time. And the conclusion came from this article, this recent article in last year published. Regarding adequacy of dialysis, as reported in the literature, refers to biochemical outcome measures, most of which are not related to patient-relevant outcome. For patient adequate dialysis is dialysis that enables them to spend as much quality time in their life as possible. Hemodialysis patient symptomatic burden can be mitigated. Symptoms identified as more important, including fatigue and drop in blood pressure and the cramping. And as I said, we should try to improve these symptoms by any means. Many of the most commonly reported symptoms among hemodialysis patients and care parents, partners were identified and be, as being more important than life expectancy itself. If we look here, fatigue, it's almost 100% of our patients complaining of fatigue, and you know why pay attention to this. And we are talking to the patient, oh, your KT over V is excellent, you are okay, you are like a horse. But actually he is actually wanted to kill the doctor because he feels fatigued and he cannot practice his life as normal population. Both dialysis fatigue is a forgotten major issue, as I said. In this issue of American Journal of Kidney Disease last year, Jacobson reviewed 65 international studies with almost 2,000 participants. What did they find? The patient experienced debilitating and relentless exhaustion because of hemodialysis-related fatigue, which encompasses their whole body and can persist beyond the immediate treatment time. Patients feel that hemodialysis-related fatigue can lead to misunderstanding when they fail to meet the expectations of friends and family. I will skip some slides because of the time. Here, these are the pathophysiology or the pathogenesis of this post-dialysis fatigue. We shall concentrate also again on the dialysis adequacy. It is one of the major issues in this issue. And also on this slide, the same. To sum up the post-dialysis fatigue issue, the lack of adequate method for measurement and the lack of provider awareness and the complex pathogenesis of fatigue have confounded the development of effective intervention to treat fatigue. There is a strong need to develop improved assessment methods and investigate the role of other contributing factors, especially the inflammatory mediators or inflammatory cytokines in fatigue with end-stage disease. And actually, we are busy always with talking about we are talking much more and more about cytokines and leaving the patient fatigued at his home. Post-dialysis recovery time, why it does matter? Each 1 hour, as I said before, dialysis related fatigue is quantifiable valid measure of post-dialysis fatigue. Each 1 hour of post-dialysis recovery time was associated with 3% and 5% increase in the hospitalization and death respectively. And more frequent dialysis can solve this problem. Up to 87% of the patient can improve marvelously, and 98% can improve from hours to minutes with nocturnal hemodialysis. And we should put in mind that each hour post-dialysis fatigue equal 5% increment of the post-dialysis, death or mortality rate. So this is a poster presentation from the last latest American Society of Nephrology Kidney Week in 2019. They studied almost 100,000 patients, and they asked them only one question: how long does it take to be able to return to your normal activity after your work? And this was the results. They came to conclude that optimizing hemodialysis treatment personalized in a personalized manner may improve the health-related quality of life and outcomes. So always there is a tension between dialysis patient, desire of the nephrologist call, impact overall health outcome. Can dialysis recovery time can be improved? And from this pilot study, actually, they came to conclude that reducing the blood flow or longer dialysis or manipulating the dialysis sodium can, and also dialysis temperature can improve the post-dialysis recovery time. So the most dramatic improvement of prolonged dialysis recovery time has been achieved with increased dialysis frequency and longer time nocturnal dialysis. Other associated factors that may influence post-dialysis fatigue are intradialytic blood flow rate and ultrafiltration rate. Conclusion and take-home message. End-stage renal disease is a chronic lifelong disease, and quality of life, that means feeling good without symptoms, matters equally, if not more, to patients than mortality. Adequate KT over V does not provide optimal dialysis, so KT over V should be a means, not a goal. Our goal we should have for our patient to give him or to offer him comfortable dialysis with normal blood pressure, high quality of life, and survival that almost equal to the kidney transplantation. Although highly prevalent, fatigue is often unrecognized, undertreated symptom in the hemodialysis patient. Post-dialysis fatigue is a complex set of symptoms. Dialysis recovery time is a quantifiable, validated measure of post-dialysis fatigue. A one-size-fits-all approach is unlikely to decrease all patient dialysis recovery time given in its multifactorial complexity. Globally, 27% of patients have reported dialysis recovery time more than 6 hours, while almost 70% of patients reported taking more than 2 hours to recover from dialysis session. Individualized prescription in patients undergoing thrice weekly hemodialysis may present an opportunity or a chance for the nephrologist to reduce the dialysis recovery time in some of their patients, so will be reflected positively in their quality of life in a meaningful way. Self-reported dialysis recovery time quantitatively measures how well the patient tolerates hemodialysis and feels afterward in association with traditional quality measures and outcome. Because the dialysis recovery time coefficient is easy to administer, has high response rates, and it can be used to identify patients with poor quality of life and high risk of dying. It's possibly could be used as an audit measure of the quality of dialysis treatment and surrogate outcome to test dialysis-related intervention in randomized controlled trials. Further research is needed to evaluate the effectiveness and the impact of these intervention in the optimization of patient-centered quality of life in dialysis population. And before I will end, again and again, we should stress on focus on this very important common issue is this post-dialysis fatigue. And I think dialysis is not the optimum solution for our patient. I think maybe after 40 years or 50 years, the junior doctors, we shall not be there, inshallah. But anyways, they will tell each other in a sarcastic way, oh, you remember they take the blood of the patient outside and they return it back, and it will be a joke among them, actually. What are we doing? I don't know. Anyway, thank you very much.